Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming today on a very rainy day, but it's great to see everybody. This is one of several scheduled town hall meetings that we have to report on progress for Stony Brook University's plan on diversity, equity, and inclusion. And I'm so glad again to see such a great turnout for this. This is a core value and mission for the university, something we implemented in May, started in May. Released it in May, and there's been a tremendous amount of work progressing on it. And the reason is because it's so extraordinarily important for our university and who we are as a campus community. I don't need to tell you that these are troubling times right now. Many people have concerns. So I think it's more important than ever that Stony Brook University be a place where we value all of the members of this community. And we value people independent of race, ethnicity, gender, religion, veteran status, ability, age, none of those things matter to us. We value you for your contributions and the differences you make to this university. So it's very important that we have a campus climate and we have policies, procedures, and culture that reflects that. So that's what the diversity plan is about. The overarching goals are listed up here. I think it's worth repeating them because they're important. We want to improve the diversity of the Stony Brook community through enhanced recruitment and retention. That's about our faculty, our staff, and our student body, making sure it reflects the diversity that we want to see at the university and in our country. We want to expand educational, research, healthcare, and other efforts to ensure that Stony Brook students have the ability to thrive as members of the campus community and as global citizens of a diverse society. Support the development of a campus climate that values diversity, equity, and inclusion in a way that promotes the ability of members of the community to thrive and to achieve their individual goals. And I think maybe one of the most important things is establish a culture of accountability and assessment around diversity and inclusion initiatives and policies. We have to be accountable for our progress in this, and it's very important that we do so going forward. And it's very important that we measure our progress and find the things that are making a difference, evaluate programs we're putting forward, and making sure that they're actually moving the needle and making a difference. And that's a critical part of the inclusion and diversity plan. So what have we been doing? Over the past few months, there's been a number of accomplishments. We presented to the University Council, that's kind of the cabinet of the university, and talked about what we're doing, got their buy-in in the plan, and made it absolutely clear to them that I hold each of the deans and the vice presidents accountable for diversity in their schools and their areas. That's the accountability we were talking about. We have the numbers for every section, every department, in the university. We know what they look like in terms of diversity for faculty and staff, so we know where we need to improve and where difference and change has to happen. So that type of accountability was very important. And the deans, the vice presidents, wholeheartedly accepted the challenge of improving diversity and our culture of equity and inclusion at Stony Brook University. We've created the Diversity Plan website, which all of you can access, which really serves as a platform for communication of information and accounts of the progress that we're making as we move the plan forward. We created the READY program, which you'll hear more about in a few minutes, really designed to address faculty and staff hidden biases. This has been very successful so far. We're going to continue to try and expand it and push it forward, but it's a very important part of getting to those issues around the hidden biases that many of us may be unaware that we have, but may make a difference in how we perceive people, in our hiring practices, may cause discrimination, again, that may be hidden, that we're unaware of, but ends up countering our efforts to improve diversity and equity at the university. We will appoint a chief diversity officer. That position has been described. People are being interviewed for that position now, and they will be responsible for the day-to-day implementation of the diversity plan, so a key position. We're expanding the Office of Institutional Diversity's Equities effort to address accessibility. So working in terms of accessibility to all parts of the campus, to every parts of information that are being disseminated to the campus, making this campus, again, accessible, creating a better climate of diversity and equity and inclusion. And Marjorie Leonard, who's in the audience, I see there, has been appointed as the ADA coordinator to help lead that effort, in addition to her efforts leading our Title IX work on campus. We've been analyzing data, diversity-related data collected, analyzed, and presented to various stakeholders. It turned out there's a lot of data that we had at the university that we hadn't really gone through and put it together, collated it, and in a way that we can analyze it and really start to understand where are the issues, where are the areas where we have issues around diversity, where are the areas where we need to improve, and putting that data together has been a very important step. We have a chosen or preferred name policy implemented that applies to students and employees. That was an important step. The Campus Unity Council has been created, and my thanks to those of you who are serving on that council. I think it's very important in terms, again, creating this culture of diversity and inclusion that we're looking for. The UDP and Student Affairs Building Understanding and Relationships have sponsored a Citizens Police Academy, Coffee with Cops, and USG-sponsored game days. All of this are designed to bring together the university police and our students together so they can begin to communicate and understand each other, break down those barriers that may arise from miscommunication, make it so people understand each other's needs, understand the jobs of the police, understand what students are looking for in their campus experience, making sure that we reduce some of those barriers that may exist between those people. New student opening weekend and first year seminar course. We've done more to make sure we include diversity and inclusion in the content that we're giving to our students who are coming in. From the time, even before you come to Stony Brook University, we want you to be aware that this is an institution that values diversity, that you're going to come to a place that values inclusion. We want to make sure students know that before they arrive, and it's emphasized on the day they arrive, that this is the culture we strive for at the university. We've had West Campus new employee orientation, again, modified to make the introduction to the campus more welcome, and again, to also help educate people about diversity and about hidden biases, again, from the beginning of their time at the university. We've done more to increase recruitment. We've been working to increase recruitment of students of color to the university. We put aside a sum of money now to help those recruitment efforts. We're getting students engaged. This is something we heard from students. They want to be engaged in the recruitment and help us in the recruitment. So they're going to be involved now in helping us do outreach to particular high schools and helping to welcome students who come to the university to show that there is support available when you come to Stony Brook University. Those are important things that we're going to be able to do. And we put funds aside to fund that as well. We put about $1 million, $750,000 to $1 million in to this initial work for diversity. We want to do more. We look to do more. Part of what we want to do, again, as I talked about, is understand what's working as we move forward, understand what the interventions are that work, and then we could put more funding into those things that really are making a difference and moving the needle forward. But it's an extraordinarily important part. And even these budget-challenged times, so these are tough budget times for Stony Brook and SUNY and the state, we're going to continue to make diversity a priority as we move forward. So I think I'm going to wrap there. And I'd like to introduce Rick Gateau and Cheryl Chambers to talk a little bit about how we've organized the structure of this plan and to serve as MCs for this meeting.
Great. Thank you, President Stanley. Thank you. So again, I'm Rick Gateau, and I wanted to welcome Cheryl Chambers as well to help co-facilitate this session this afternoon. As President Stanley said, we are here today to talk about updates to the diversity plan, offer feedback, ask questions. We are going to hear in a moment from the chairs of the various working groups, followed by a brief presentation on the READY initiative that Dr. Stanley mentioned, which is focused on hidden bias. We'll then hear from one of our students about how Stony Brook students are engaged in this process, followed by a question and answer session with all of you. I'd like to begin by talking briefly about our implementation structure. Our goal is to have an inclusive structure in place to ensure that we gather input and make progress towards achieving these diversity-focused initiatives. To accomplish this goal, there are three overarching working groups that work collaboratively on the university's diversity plan. And each group's membership, if you haven't looked, it's noted on the diversity plan at stonybrook.edu/diversity plan. First, we have the steering committee, which is the leadership group that determines priorities, identifies funding, and clears obstacles to progress. Second, we have the advisory council, which includes a diverse membership of students, faculty, and staff. The council members serve as ambassadors to the diversity plan, evaluate and review ideas, recommendations, and strategies. They make suggestions regarding implementation and look at new areas of focus. And finally, our working groups. We have 8 working groups established that began meeting over the summer, and they've each cover a specific portion of the plan. Each group recently submitted its first draft of priorities for 2017. These priorities will be reviewed by the Steering Committee for Implementation and assessed by the Advisory Council in the coming weeks. Now today, we have four brief presentations by four of the working groups. They'll present status updates on their team's work, including highlights of some of their components related to recommendations. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first presenter, Lynn Johnson, the Vice President for Human Resource Services.
Thank you. I'm hoping everyone can hear me okay. So I'm very pleased to be a part of this today and very pleased to be a part of the whole plan. It's wonderful to be part of something that is growing and dynamic. And it's also very nice to be here to highlight the work of the working group, the non-faculty working group that's been working very hard to bring some new initiatives to light. So what I wanted to start off by doing is telling you a little bit about what they've been doing and a little bit about what they plan to do next year. Just some real highlights, because as you heard, I have just a couple of minutes to speak. So the group started off by really analyzing what were the needs of the campus and those coming to newly to campus. We looked very much to the responses to the initial diversity plan. And we identified, or they identified, some core items that they thought we should work on. And I'm going to highlight just two of them, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about 2017. So if we take the first item. This is really talking about making the campus feel more welcoming to new employees. And President Stanley actually already touched on this. One of the things we did was sort of start to enhance the onboarding process. So some of the forms that used to be, for example, in orientation, so it was a lot of time spent filling out forms, can now be done online, which means that new employee orientation can really be used to focus on welcoming people to campus, telling them about facilities, telling them about different groups they might want to be a part of, and making them feel truly welcome to this new environment. We're creating tools to help departments onboard their new staff, because when you think about it, the place that really you want to feel very welcome is in your new department. And then we're doing things that are mentioned up here, where we talk about a very formal part of checking in. Every 30 and 90 days in the first year, we'll be checking in with those new hires to say, how's it going? Because we do really care that folks feel acclimated to campus as quickly as possible. So we'll be checking in with them. And what this slide tells you is a little bit about how we plan on doing that. Because we think that if we get information early on, and if there's any issues around equity, inclusion, diversity, let's find out about them, let's help track them, and let's help solve them, because we want people to feel very welcome. So that's the first thing that the group has been working hard on and really doing some nice work in terms of implementation. The second thing they're doing is expanding our outreach. And we know outreach is very important. And actually, it's the job of all of us, which I'll talk about in a little minute. Specifically, Human Resources and the Office of Diversity and Inclusion will be working to create community partnerships. They've already started doing it. So, for example, they're bringing the Young Adult Institute, which is a National Institute for People with Disabilities, to campus to meet with some departments to talk about how they can partner with the departments and their clients. We're working with to develop job fair events. And we'll be looking perhaps to some of you to come with us to those job fairs so that we can really tell people what the campus is like. We're working with the Department of Labor in their one-stop center, where we're building a campus calendar of job events, job fair events. And we already went to the Veterans Job Fair at Suffolk Community College in Brentwood. So that's just a taste of some of the things that have already gone on. But I want to make the point that outreach is not just the work of OIDE or Human Resources, and that's Human Resources across all the campus, the West Campus, the hospital, and the Veterans Home. It's really the work of the entire community. You know, we can be welcoming at orientation, but if the department isn't welcoming, the person won't feel welcomed. So it's the work of the entire campus to help us in expanding outreach and welcome. And one of the ways that you, as individuals, can expand that outreach is to send postings, copies of postings, to friends, to colleagues, to professional groups, to community groups. Very easy in the talent management system. Just click a button, send it to a friend, and you can share those opportunities. And maybe it's a promotional opportunity. You know a friend or a colleague at the university who would be well suited for a promotional position. This is something you can do to help. And my final point is some of the items we're going to be doing in 2017. I'm only going to pick three of them. So we're going to revitalize the welcome wagon. That's a very important thing for us. This is helping people that are actually relocating to the area as well as relocating to a new job, helping them to find what's important to them in the community. We're going to continue to enhance the exit interview process, and that's important because sometimes that points opportunities to us. It gives us indicators of opportunities for improvement. So the exit interview process is important. And we're going to build into our current professional development trainings more information around diversity, inclusion, and equity. Because we think, for example, in supervisory training, every supervisor should know what that means and be able to embrace the concept. So lots of important work has been done, lots more to do. Great to be part of it. I'm glad you'll all be a part of it too. And I'm going to hand over now to our Dean of Students, Tim Eklund, who's going to talk about the Student Working Group.
Thank you, Lynn, and thank you all for coming today. This has been a really great process to be a part of, and I wanted to just tell you a little bit about what we've been doing on the undergraduate working group, and I'd like to also recognize Shelley Germana, who is a co-chair of the undergraduate working group with me. So thank you, Shelley. Yes, let's give her a round of applause. So as you can see on the slide, what we wanted to do is get as many people involved in the undergraduate working group as we could. We have 19 members, which includes a variety of staff and students and faculty. We've been meeting since the middle of June, working on the plan. We've met 13 times officially as a full group, and we have had several subcommittee meetings in between that. So it's been a very hard working group. The approach that the committee has taken was to first look at the full diversity plan and do a rather rigorous review of each item in the plan to determine whether it was something that would be important to the undergraduate student experience. So we looked at 69 different items as a full group and identified 40 of them as applying to our undergraduate student experience. From there, we looked at themes and clusters around those items and developed subgroups or subcommittees, lead groups to look at each of those more specifically, and the group broke up into those subcommittees. The committees then took the different items from the plan that were a part of their review and prioritized those into their top three priorities. With that, we also asked the subgroups to create to take a ghost strategic planning process, which is setting goals, objectives, strategies, and tactics, and we were holding each other accountable on a regular basis for the work that we were doing, knowing that this is important for us to continue to make progress on the plan and really focus on how do we get the items that are in the plan committed to some kind of action and strategy. The subcommittees we came up with are our recruitment and admissions subcommittee, student engagement, involvement, and retention, our curriculum subcommittee, training, and campus climate. And a sampling, I just wanted to give you a sampling of the priorities that have been established. These are five of the 15 different priorities that have been submitted. The first one we thought would be important to work on, and this came out of our curriculum committee that was chaired by Shelley, is to require all new students to attend a one-hour course on diversity and a one-hour course on gender during our opening weekend. The second item, which came from our campus climate and was led by Jarvis Watson, is to explore the reestablishing of the Diversity Fellows program, consisting of trained volunteers from campus who act as a team of facilitators during events and lead discussions and after activities, lectures, and symposia. Our third item, which came out of our student engagement, involvement, and retention group, which is led by Christine Noonan, looked at offering ongoing programs for international and non-English-speaking students that will help them learn cross-cultural and context-specific communication skills to enhance their academic and personal experience at Stony Brook University and to promote their professional development. The fourth item, which came out of recruitment and admissions and is led by Judy Brahannon, is to identify and add a variety of activities to the recruitment calendar. These may include adding campus visits, holding call-a-thons by current students and alumni, adding additional alumni events for admitted students, and improving communication with guidance counselors at targeted schools. And then the last one that I wanted to share with you today is by our training committee, and this committee is led by Ahmed Balazi. And this item is to explore the availability of or develop training pertaining to implicit bias and cultural sensitivity, particularly as it relates to students and employees. But the student point piece is the one that we're really looking at taking up. So that's a sampling of what the undergraduate working group has been working on. I think we're very excited now to look at take the priorities that have been established and begin coming up with additional action plans for their implementation. And now I'd like to introduce Nancy Goroff, professor of chemistry and chair of graduate, postdoc, and professional students.
Thank you, Tim. So the graduate and professional students and postdoctoral scholars working group, which I co-chair with Jenny Williams, has focused on three different areas. Those are recruiting of new students, persistence and success once students are here, and culture and climate. So this is very similar to what you've heard already in the context of staff and undergraduates. For graduate students and professional students, we have something on campus already located in the graduate school, which we're very proud of, the Center for Inclusive Education. And so our working group started by making sure we knew what was already happening in the Center for Inclusive Education, which is a nationally recognized center focused exactly on these issues, primarily for graduate students, but with some programs that are for professional students and postdocs. So we started by learning what they're doing already and also what the diversity efforts are on East Campus to make sure that we were recommending things that complemented those. And we also heard from Dr. Bonita London, who's a faculty member in psychology, who does research through the Center for Inclusive Education or in collaboration with the CIE on what are the most effective practices in these areas. So we're really fortunate to have this expertise on campus, and all of our recommendations took into account what we heard from Professor London. So in the area of recruiting, we picked out several things. I'm not going to read through each of them here, but there are a couple I want to emphasize. One is that we have now in the Center for Inclusive Education a recruiter position that is jointly funded from the President's Office and from the IACS, the Institute for Advanced Computational Sciences. And Rosalia Davi, who is our diversity outreach coordinator, is here. And one of our recommendations is to do a real assessment of that kind of partnership with our research institutes on campus and look for opportunities for further collaboration to do more active recruiting of a diverse set of students. There's already other efforts going on, as I said. Another is to really develop more collaborations between the CIE and the dental and the medical schools, because they have operated more or less independently in the area of recruiting up till now, and there are a lot of opportunities for collaboration there. We also recommended partnering with the LSAMP, Lewis Stokes Alliance for Minority Participation Schools, which are Stony Brook is leading one of the LSAMP programs. This is an undergraduate focused program for getting students to go into graduate school in the sciences. And so we should be using those for recruiting. We already are, but we can use them more. And at the postdoc level, there's a specific recommendation, and I believe that Stella Tsirko will talk a little bit more about the form that that has taken, but there's a specific recommendation in the diversity plan to develop a presidential fellows program for bringing really excellent, outstanding postdocs from underrepresented minorities to campus as a way of developing potential faculty to stay here and so on. In the area of persistence and success, what we really heard from the students on our working group, especially the professional students, is that they needed more of the same kind of mentoring that the CIE is now presenting to doctoral students. And so one of our key recommendations is to expand the CIE's purview explicitly to include professional students in this area. We also wanted to develop more workshops. We have some workshops that are explicitly for students who are funded through particular grants, but making those available to more of our underrepresented minority students so that they can understand the context that they are in and what strategies work best. But our focus much more is on what support we can provide to them in terms of mentoring. And what we heard was that they wanted more mentoring opportunities and more community building activities, which brings us into the culture and climate piece, where you will hear more about the READY training, which I had the pleasure of participating in yesterday. And so we think that that's very important for our faculty and staff to provide an appropriate culture and climate for students. But what we learned from Dr. London was that we need to do more than that. We need to do that, and we also need to train faculty about specific issues such as growth versus entity mindset of intelligence. Dr. London's research shows that students who are in departments with faculty who believe, so a growth mindset about idea of intelligence says that you can become more skilled and more capable and more measure better on intelligence tests even by learning and through experience, whereas an entity mindset says you're just born with whatever you have. And what Dr. London's research shows, not only is the second mindset counter to all research in the area, but also students who are in departments where they perceive that the faculty have an entity mindset are less likely to be successful than students who perceive that their faculty mentors have a growth mindset. So it's kind of a meta thing. So we think it's very important for our faculty to be aware of all of this research and other things about perceived identity compatibility between one's personal identity and one's professional identity, and ways of giving constructive feedback. All of these are research-based results that we want to make sure the faculty get training in. So those were our key recommendations, and now I want to introduce Professor Stella Tsirko from the Department of Pharmacology, who is also Deputy Provost and Vice Provost for Faculty Affairs, and is co-chair of the Faculty Working Group.
Good afternoon. The faculty working group tried to continue the effort that we started some time ago to talk to a lot of the faculty from diverse backgrounds on campus and then put together a committee that is representative of all sides of the campus. We also tried to interact with additional, with members of other committees. You may notice Jeannie Williams, who is the co-chair of the Graduate Student Postdoc and Professional Committee, as part of that, Bonita London. And also, we engaged people with established contributions and experience to diversity, like Nina Wong, who had been for a long time the CIE, Center for Inclusive Education Director. So we tried to talk to a lot of people. We got together, we met over the summer several times, and we decided to work on two separate issues for form two different subcommittees, one that would be involved with the concept of faculty recruitment, and the second that would be involved with faculty retention and life experiences on campus. So for the recruitment part, it is very clear that we need to continue our searches, either open searches or targeted searches, and increase the number of underrepresented faculty in the different disciplines on campus. How can we do that? We need to, one relatively straightforward way to do that would be to engage in the searches specific networks of professional networks of faculty and PhD networks that exist across the country and be able to reach out and engage them in participating in the searches that we do. The second way that we thought it would be important to increase our recruitment of underrepresented faculty would be to actually establish Stony Brook as a welcoming hub for diversity, for faculty. And to do that, we thought that a good way to move forward would be to establish workshops, nationally known, recognized workshops, either annual or biannual. That would be professional networking workshops for postdocs, for even for junior faculty. And that way, establish the idea, the concept that Stony Brook is the place to be. So these were the initial two recommendations. We have some tweaking that we're doing in this for recruitment. What we thought, though, that is very, very important is once the faculty arrive here, to have the appropriate welcoming environment that will let them, that would get them nurtured and flourish in their careers here. So in their retention subcommittee recommendations, that came to the top was to establish much tighter connections between the faculty at Stony Brook and the community. Present the university to the community as an amazing resource, resource that has to do with knowledge, it has to do with art and music, it has to do with athletics, it has to do with all the things, and of course with health, all the things that we do that are so special here. It may be important to do that, to have specific people who act as liaisons and connect the two communities much more than they do. So that would be connecting with the community. What is also important is to make sure that the environment here at Stony Brook is a good social environment for our faculty. And on that, the example that the Center for Inclusive Education has set for the graduate students, if we expand on that, that would be a wonderful template to start working on. Professional development from the questions that we asked the faculty became as an important topic that needs to be developed furthermore, more official mentoring for faculty, both of underrepresented faculty and all faculty would be important. And in fact, we are starting this spring with mentoring workshops that will be announced to the faculty and be invited for people to will invite people to participate. And finally, we thought that it is important to show both to the university and to the community how proud we are of our faculty, of our underrepresented faculty, and showcase them as the wonderful scholars and people that they are. So these were the initial recommendations, and we're still working on our tweaking our guidelines and setting up more specifics to that. Thank you.
please join me in thanking all of the co-chairs for the work that they have provided leadership in, and also in thanking all of the many committee members who've been participating in this process. Thank you. So one of the key needs that was identified by students was for there to be training around rooting out the hidden bias that exists in some of our classrooms. So in response to this, this need, which is a very important need as we move forward with our diversity plan, Robbie Kincaid has been brought on to serve as the project director for the READY initiative. That is responding to equity, diversity, and inclusion. As many of you may know, Robbie is a clinical assistant professor in the School of Health Technology and Management, as well as the School of Medicine. And she's been in this capacity for over 30 years. She has over 30 years of professional experience in education and training in health and human services, both on the state and the national level. So we are really pleased and quite fortunate to have her here at Stony Brook. She has developed and implemented a myriad of health and cultural competence related presentations, workshops, programs, etc. So we're going to ask Robbie to share with us the READY project and give us a general overview. Robbie Kincaid.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. It's good to see you. It's warming to see the diversity in this room. I think it makes our jobs here at Stony Brook that much easier because we do have such a wonderfully diverse population of not only faculty and staff, but students. So it makes me feel real good to see you all here today. The first myth I want to dispel is that READY is not a training. It is a seminar. There is a difference. When we speak in terms of training and seminars, I like to think of a seminar as more of a discussion and a contributory process versus one where people are told what to do. So to that end, I just want to talk to you about our seminar and to share with you that it is born out of our diversity plan that we have here at Stony Brook. And what we try to do with the READY seminars is to broaden our definition of diversity. As Dr. Stanley pointed out, it's not just about race and ethnicity. It includes gender identity, military status, and so on and so forth. But we definitely want to raise the awareness of implicit bias that people have, and also to involve people in an experiential activity versus one that's more didactic. That is not to say that there isn't information given or didactic material that is shared through the READY project, but the READY project in itself is a six-hour experiential process for faculty and staff. The dissemination plan is how do we plan on getting people who are faculty and staff at Stony Brook to participate in the READY seminars. And there's a theory out there called the theory of diffusion of innovation. I'm not going to go into detail about that, but it basically just tells us how to go about making sure that all faculty and staff on campus are encouraged and invited to voluntarily at this point come to the seminars. I would go on to say that because I can't see very well, the sustainability of our program is going to be very good. And because of that, we're going to have people who come to our seminars, which are 6 hours at a time. They will then in turn decide whether or not they want to facilitate as service to our community these seminars. It's a rigorous process. It's a training of facilitators. And the training of facilitators is a three-day event. Two of those days would probably be working days. One day is a day that we would give in, you know, give up as service to the community. But just to talk about that a little bit, I want to share that currently I am doing the training, the facilitating of the seminars with co-facilitators, but we want to broaden the expanse. I mean, I do really good things, I think, but we need a lot of people to be involved. So I really encourage those of you who have been through the seminar and know what it entails to consider coming to the training of facilitators so that we can roll this out in a ripple effect. The last thing I just want to share about the READY seminar is to date, we've done, in November, we've done five. We have 8 scheduled for December, and we're at waitlisted. So this is all word of mouth. Going to the diversity seminar, some of it has to do with going on what I call the ready tours, where I've gone to different departments and talked to members of the community about the seminars, but a lot of it has been word of mouth. People who have attended have decided to share this information with their colleagues, and that's one of the biggest ways that we're getting people to come. So I'll be here for questions and answers, so if you have want more information about ready, I'll be here. Thank you.
Thank you, Robbie, for that overview of the Ready Seminar. Okay. Now we would like to call on 2 student leaders who have been serving on the Diversity Plan Advisory Council, providing insight and advice, drawing on their experiences as campus leaders, and really helping us as a group to understand the student experience and also to move forward. And they have been very, very successful in doing that. I'd like to introduce first to you Dwayne Moore, who is a senior transfer student, sociology major, Africana studies minor here on campus, serving in several leadership capacities with the Black Student Union, as well as the College of Arts and Sciences Advisory Committee, and with the SOB chapter. Also on the Presidential Mini-Grant Committee, yes. He will be followed by Sydney Monroe Gaglio, who is a junior theater arts major here on campus, women's gender and sexuality minor, who also is involved with our LGBTA Student Alliance as an RA and also as an undergraduate assistant in the Office of LGBTQ Services. I will first hear from Dwayne and then from Sydney. Welcome.
Yes, thank you very much. When I first became president of the Black Student Union and we met with President Stanley, we gave him a list of initiatives. The thing that was really, sitting deep in my heart was making sure that it wasn't just about diversity, because diversity can be a very ambiguous term, but more about inclusiveness and making sure that if you are one, woman who's Black and who identifies as LGBTQ, and you're in a major that's, dominated by white men, you don't feel different. And you feel that you have the support of your staff, you have the support of your classmates, and you have the support of your university to push you forward in your endeavors. I mean, we feel that that wasn't necessarily the case, and that's a larger arcing issue that stems from, I think, the history of the United States. But to make sure that as students, we're advocating as hard as we can for those people who may not have the voices or the power necessarily to change public opinion. So with that, I've been a part of the advisory group to where we really want to give a different perspective, because it's easy a lot of times where you just have administrators in a room, making decisions, but they may be out of touch. They may be from a different generation. They may not have their hand on the grasp of a lot of the current situations that are happening, at least from a millennial perspective. So to really give it a different perspective and to really make sure that everyone that we can possibly, feel, and people that we talk to within our friend groups are included in this within our being. So that's my perspective on it, and that's what we want to do as students that are part of the advisory committee and a part of the diversity plan. Thank you.
Dwayne actually took a lot of the words right out of my mouth, so don't know if I have much more to say. So I do a lot of things on campus that are very queer. So one of the things I'm very excited about that has come out of the diversity plan is an LGBTQ center that is coming up next semester, hopefully, at the end of this semester. So I'm very nervous, I'm so sorry. Hi, everybody. Being a student on the advisory council has been a lot of fun for me, in that I've gotten to sit in rooms and be a student voice. One of my things, though, is that I'm one student, and there are a lot of student voices. And something that I find to be great about Stony Brook is we've put a lot of intention about diversity, equity, inclusion, and making that something that we are devoted to. One of the things that we're doing is this diversity plan, and that stems into a whole bunch of different things. Student voice is very important, and I can't speak for everybody, neither can Dwayne. That's why it's so important that we have student voice, and I appreciate being included in these sorts of meetings, because then it isn't just administrators. Moving forward, a lot of the intention has been that we are going to be getting more student voice involved, so it's not just two or three students sitting in these big meetings. We need everybody involved, and that's the idea about being not just about diversity, but about inclusion, and that's what I'm very excited about for this. So thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much, Dwayne, and thank you, Sydney, for sharing your experiences and also giving us some further insight as we move forward. Yes. So at this point in our time together, we would like to move into some questions and answers and have a brief Q&A period. As part of this meeting and as part of President Stanley's email and outreach to the campus community, we did solicit questions from you here on campus. And so what we'd like to do is to answer a few questions as well as take questions from the audience. Yes. So the questions, the first question that I would that was put before us that I would like to ask is, and someone wrote this, does the initiative plan to address the declining number of African American black students, faculty, staff, does this initiative plan to address this in any way? Many of us are concerned about retention and recruitment. How do we open up opportunities for staff members of color to move to management positions? If you cannot find qualified minority candidates for employment the traditional way, will you provide incentives to create them internally? Yes. So this question is related to, of course, employment and recruitment of faculty and staff, you know, as well as recruitment of students here on campus. I would like to call upon Lynn Johnson from our Human Resource Services area to respond to this question.
Yeah,
and
thank you.
And then we'll have response about the recruitment.
Sure.
Yes.
So actually, it's a great question. As you noticed, it's a many-part question, so I needed to think about each of those parts. I think it's important, first of all, just to correct one of the premises there. Our numbers of African American black faculty and staff has not been declining. It has increased slightly. That said, I think we should be focusing on, there's always opportunity for improvement. We should be building on that. We should be increasing our numbers in terms of diversity. And I think it's important to remember that there are opportunities for all of us to do that. You know, I mentioned in my slides, for example, that it's important that we think about colleagues and friends and people in our community that we might want to invite to join the campus, and we can do that by sharing postings with them. When we talk about promotional opportunities, again, let's watch out for our friends and colleagues and people in the community with promotional opportunities. But I would also throw out a challenge in terms of promotion and in terms of bringing diversity to campus, throw out a challenge to our supervisors, because it's very important that our supervisors, when they start recruiting for positions or recruiting for promotional positions, think about making sure that they have diverse applicant pools. And if, for example, in a search there isn't a diverse applicant pool, saying, you know what, I need to rethink the position description. I need to think about how I would post that in order to have a diverse applicant pool to choose from. So that's part of the response. I think in terms of when I think of retention, which was also part of the question, we've got to think again about inclusion. We've got to think about how do we make people feel welcome on campus and continue to feel welcome. And again, I think that's the job of all of us on campus. We in human resources or in the Office of Inclusion, Diversity and Equity can provide tools to help with that, but it really is the job of all of us. We're all ambassadors for the campus. I also think when we're talking about promotional opportunities, we should be thinking about how can we coach and mentor those that have the opportunity, could have the opportunity for success on campus. And again, that's very much the role of the supervisor. So when we talked, or when I talked at the beginning about expanding some of our professional development training, and particularly our supervisory training, one of the things I think we should be thinking of is how do we help our supervisors to think about how they can help staff to develop, to be successful, to be promoted? How can we mentor them? How can we coach them? Do we have some funds that we can use to send people to conferences or to meetings and things like that? So it's a really a group responsibility, a lot of responsibility for HR and OIDE, a lot of responsibility for supervisors, but actually a lot of responsibility for all of us to make this place even more diverse.
So let me add a couple of things to what Lynn had to say and underscore a few things. I think this is a really critical part of the diversity plan to address the first part of the question. Are we going to work to increase the number of people of color essentially at Stony Brook University at every level? The answer is yes. This is something that I think we're very concerned about. And then the question is, of course, you know, how do you go about it what are the most effective ways? And I think that to start at the faculty staff level first, making sure that every member of a search committee has undergone the ready training to look for hidden biases. So I think that's very important to making sure that the evaluations they're doing are actually accurate and correct. And I shouldn't say ready training, I should say the ready seminar. But making sure that people have attended the ready seminar, I think is very important. So I would call upon faculty, I would appeal to faculty to say, if you want to be on search committees and want to participate in this way, you should undergo this training to make sure you're bringing your best game, essentially, to this very important task. The second thing, I'm going to reiterate what Lynn said, is about making sure that the pools are diverse. If we don't have diverse pools for hire, we're not going to be able to achieve diversity. It's really that simple. And many times, unfortunately, on campus, we're confronted with pools that aren't diverse, either diverse in gender, race, ethnicity. That, as Lynn said, is a time to pause and start over again. And we need to develop ways to reach out to increase candidate pools, and there's some ways in which we may be able to do that by targeted advertising and other mechanisms, but we've got to improve our pools and make sure they're adequate. So again, I call upon the people doing the hiring in the vice presidential level, whoever's doing hiring, supervisors, to not accept pools that aren't diverse for your candidates. We need to have diverse pools. That doesn't mean that everybody who hired will be a person of color, an underrepresented minority. But as I said before, if they're not in the pool, it's not going to happen. So we have to make sure that we have diverse pools. When it comes to student recruitment, I talked a little bit about it already. One of the things that I've found most rewarding in this effort has been how engaged students want to be in helping recruit other students to Stony Brook and helping to create this community. That's something that I really value and really appreciate. And now what we're doing is trying to give the resources to help make that possible, to help fund the kind of events for students who may have been admitted, admission students who may not have made a decision yet about whether to come to Stony Brook. Can we hold an event to show them how welcome they would be if they did come to Stony Brook University? Can we do outreach again to high schools where there's a high percentage of students who would be potentially great students for Stony Brook, students of color and other students would be great students for Stony Brook? Can we hold events there with guidance counselors and with students there as well, and getting the money to support that? And that's one area in which we're spending funds to help do this. And then, as Lynn said, it's not just about recruitment, but it's about retention as well. And what are we doing to continue to make this place a welcoming place where people want to stay, particularly in those first 2 years where there's particularly vulnerability for transfer? How do we make sure that people really do feel welcome and get acclimated to Stony Brook and then are able to succeed? We have some great programs at the university that help people succeed. We know the EOP program is extraordinary in helping students graduate. How do we take some of the lessons from EOP and translate it to the student body as a whole to help people succeed at the university? All those, I think, are important issues.
Thank you. I do want to let you know that There were many questions that we had received through this process, and that we won't be able, of course, to address these questions, most of these questions, this afternoon. However, on the website, stonybrook.edu/diversityplan, there will be an FAQ, and the questions will be posted as well as the responses. So I do encourage you to read them and to go through them. But we do have time for another question. So this person wrote, the chancellor of the California state system has made a statement that the system will not cooperate with the Trump administration to assist in the deportation of undocumented students. To assuage fears that some of our students are having, do you think we should make sure our chancellor does something similar? How will you protect our international and undocumented students from deportation or police harassment? How is the university responding to Governor Cuomo's three-part plan to combat hate crimes?
So I'll talk about that. So first of all, I've been, in speaking on behalf of Stony Brook University, I've been a very public supporter of the DREAM Act and of DACA. I recently signed on again to a letter that came from more than 100 universities across the United States requesting that President-elect Trump extend DACA and not end that program that's been so important for undocumented students and undocumented individuals in the U.S. That's very much a student issue for me, and one that I'm very, very strongly supportive of. And SUNY, as a system, has been supportive of DACA as well and has signed on to other letters in support of it. So as it stands currently, nothing has changed at this point in time, right? There's been no change in immigration status, so no one is, you know, there's been no immediate change in that, but it's certainly something that people should be concerned about. Right now, we don't request or require immigration status from any applicant in the admissions process, nor is it a factor in student housing decisions. We don't provide that information to anybody, private student information to anybody. We don't provide it. And once a student is enrolled, we protect their confidentiality, of course, in line with federal and state law. And our university police department does not inquire into anybody's immigration status or other persons unless they're actually arrested for a crime. Currently, the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement policy characterizes colleges and universities as what are called sensitive locations, which means enforcement actions should not occur on a campus outside of extraordinary circumstances. So that's the current status, but again, the threat is how this could change. SUNY has issued a statement on this, and I think as a state agency and part of SUNY, this would be binding on us to some degree. And their statement is that should any action on this issue be necessary, it would have to come from the SUNY Board of Trustees. So the SUNY Board of Trustees, so individual campus presidents would not have the ability to set policy on their campus, it would have to come from the SUNY Board of Trustees. But again, they state their support of DACA, and their continued commitment to trying to make sure that that is extended. Our current student judicial system and employee rules and regulations, I think, do address unacceptable behavior, hate crimes, and the University Police Department, working with Suffolk County Police, would be involved in any criminal charges that were brought in association with hate crimes. So we certainly support the kind of attitude that Governor Cuomo has had about New York State being a place that values diversity, that values inclusion, that values the contributions of immigrants to our country. This is the home of the Statue of Liberty, as he said so eloquently. We stand for value, we stand for opportunity, essentially, for every individual, and my hope is that that will be reflected in any actions that are taken by SUNY and the state.
Thank you. Thank you, President Stanley.
So we know we're at the top of the hour, but we did want to set aside a few minutes to ask, have you all ask questions. We do have microphones on either side of the room. If you'd like to ask a question, please feel free. If you could just wait to be called upon, and then if you could share your name with us and your affiliation with the university, that would be helpful, and then we'll direct your question to the appropriate person. You're first, please.
Hi, I'm Samantha. I am the Vice President of Phi Rho Epsilon Sisterhood. I'm also a member of the Black History Month Committee, and I have many, many things to say. So the first thing I want to say is that I understand like numbers matter and stuff like that, but before trying to increase the number of diversity, you have to think about the environment itself. How are the students you currently have feeling? So for me, I think that in order to appeal to those students who come on the tours and see us, you have to know that the social environment they're entering and seeing is something that they would want to be a part of. So I think one thing that we should tackle is the ability of students to gather, because with the way that the new dining system is, it's like all of those places that we used to be able to go and like just be around each other and feel like we're a community, that has been taken away, because if you don't have a meal plan, if you don't have this and that, you have to spend money to enter certain buildings now that we usually used to be able to convene in. So that's a problem. The penthouses that used to be in my building and many of the buildings around me have been taken away to create more dorms, which will be small and uncomfortable like they already are. And that used to be an area where we were able to meet if we didn't have a room booked. And I think that the fact that for us to even want to be around each other publicly for a long period of time to even speak about things that are on our mind, we have to book a room. And if you can't book a room, then you're left to do what? To gather in your small dorm, and it's just not comfortable. So I think we need to develop areas that are safe spaces, open to us for us to meet without having to go through a long process of booking a month in advance, when there's sometimes things just happen and you just need a space to be together. Another thing I'm thinking is, as far as orientation, we have orientation leaders that, you know, go through a process to be qualified and stuff like that and get that position. But I feel like there should be more interaction between the students and the people on tour. So I'm thinking about things like welcome wagon and all of those things that they have for students who do orientation. There should be a way that organizations and clubs, they should have representatives who are able to come to orientation weekend and like participate, have like things set up to show the students that, you know, if you are affiliated with this religion or this gender, this sexuality or whatever, these are things that you can find when you come to school, instead of coming to the school and being alone for the first 2 weeks until, you know, you so happen to stumble upon something. Also, I think that we should try to work on our relations with the community outside of our school, because I know that there are a lot of commuters and this and that, and I know that it's difficult to find even off-campus housing that's near to the school because of the tension between students and then the outside community. So I think we need to work on that as well, because students who come here to on the tours, if they see that we don't look happy being here, they're not gonna wanna accept, they're not gonna wanna come. And if we're unhappy, who am I that I'm gonna go recommend this school to somebody else?
Great points, thank you. Would anybody kind of like to share any response?
Hi, Samantha. I think you bring up a lot of really important points. And you know, to start with the first point in regards to finding more gathering space and to make space on campus more accommodating. I think that's something that the undergraduate working group is actively looking at. We know that one of the points in the diversity plan is to renovate spaces to make those spaces more accommodating for students, just for the reasons that you're saying. So that is one of the things that we're looking at as priority in the plan. The opening, I think some of what you were saying has to do with the dining areas on campus that are now the all dine-in areas. And I hope you've noticed that with Eastside Dining, that there's been, you know, that complex is set up a little bit differently because we just built it and just opened it. And hopefully we can make that a more accommodating space. We've moving the Unity Cultural Center into the Student Activity Center has been one of the things that we are hopeful will also bring more students to a space where they can gather and, you know, spend time together in that way. And when we finish the new student union or the new student service center, we're hoping that that will also, that the plans are to, for that to have additional space.
Would you like to say?
Hello, my name is Perla. Along with Sam, I'm also part of Phi Rho Epsilon. I'm also part of the Black Student Union. I am a junior here at Stony Brook. I have two questions. One, during the talk, you guys mentioned that there were target schools, like high schools that you guys were going towards, you know, to try to encourage other populations to attend Stony Brook. And I was wondering what locations those target schools were in, because the 6% that you have in Stony now aren't from Long Island, most of them. You know, like we don't come from here. So if the target schools are in Long Island, I'm a little nervous. So if the target schools are in Long Island, I don't know how effective that would be. That was my first question. My second one is, given the president-elect that we have now and the way his campaign was run, has the diversity, like, is there a plan to make the diversity plan a little bit more aggressive given, you know, like what this nation is facing at this moment? So those are my two questions.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody want to?
So I'll start. Let me start with this answer to the second one first. I didn't say it explicitly perhaps at the beginning, but I was trying to say, I think what we're trying to do on this campus has never been more important, that I think we have to make sure that in a world that seems to be retreating in some sense from ideals that all of us have had, it's more important than ever that Stony Brook University stand for what we believe is right. And that is an absolute unwavering commitment to diversity and inclusion. And that, I think, we can't pull away from. So I certainly feel what's happening in the environment, feel the stresses and pressures, and I think we're going to feel them more on the campus as time goes on. I don't think see things getting better necessarily outside in the near term. So I think this is incredibly important, and it was a high priority before, honestly. It was a high priority back in May. It remains a very high priority, but it's possible that circumstances will force us to try and move even faster. As I said before, one thing I really want to do is try when possible to do evidence-based things, to do things that we think are going to work, because our resources are always limited. You know, at Stony Brook, I wish I had $50 million to spend on diversity. I think that would be about the right number, I think, if you asked me what was necessary to really make the kind of changes we do. But we're going to really do everything we can with the money we have, but that means really trying to do things that are evidence-based, to understand kind of what are things that actually work, what are things that make a difference. So I think that's important. So that often takes a little longer to do it that way, to do something, then measure its effectiveness takes a little longer, but ultimately that can help guide bigger investment. So my answer is it's incredibly important. It feels more important than it ever has based on what's happening, and things may drive us, but it was a high priority and it's still a very, very high priority. Second question, Bronx, Brooklyn, Rodney Morrison. I don't know if Rodney's here. Is Rodney here? He just left, okay, so got work to do in recruitment, so he left. But Rodney and others know the high schools, know where there's outstanding potential students, but those would be in the areas probably more than Long Island. There's certainly areas in Long Island where there are, as you know, a higher representation of students of color, so we target those already. We have programs with Wyandanch, for example, and Brentwood High School, so we have programs with them, some related to STEM, for example. But I think probably more effort, at least in terms of recruit, may be going to some of the high schools in the city itself.
Great. I know we are really at time, but I would like to ask our folks who are still wanting to ask questions. We'll stick around on the panel if you want to come up and we'll chat for a bit. But I know people have class at 2:20, I think a lot do, so yes. We don't want you to be late for class.
I also would like to add, if I may, that on the Diversity Plan website, there is a link. So those of you who have questions that we're not able to hear today, please post your questions. Anyone in the audience who has questions, you can post on the website, and your questions will be answered and will be viewable for everyone to see. Yes. Okay, so we have the that link on the website, as well as where we'll post the questions that we received, you know, for this first town hall meeting. Yeah.
Thank you.
So in the interest of time and all, we'd like to, you know, bring things to a close. Thank you for taking the time to be here today.
Thank you.
Next town hall meeting will be on December 14th. We'd like to thank all of our panelists as well. Thank you very much, and have a great day.